Hey, horse people, we're back. Part three. Riding Miss Dixie from the sanctuary that asked for help. Don't come here hating on me.
And so right now...
So how do we break that dependency on each other? Because he doesn't need her, but she needs to be with him.
Okay, how do we break that? That's the wrong terminology. Because when I hear breaking a horse, that means you break the spirit. How do you break this? Kind of means like, how do we beat it out of him? I don't think he's saying that, but somebody's going to get here with terminology and say, you got to break that bond. You got to break him up. You can't let him do that. You don't want to break that up. You want that to come naturally. When this horse is older and more secure, it won't need this. The reason why this horse doesn't need the baby is he's older and more secure, or she's older and more secure. She doesn't need the baby. She feels comfort. She's been around for a while. This is a new young baby. That's normal behavior. It's like trying to get a kid saying, you know what? This kid's like 3 years old and wants to hang around his mom too much. How do I break that? Let me put this kid on the highway and make it play in cars so it's not so dependent on mom. I mean, that's just crazy.
Oh, she's new?
No, I mean, it could be because she didn't have a companion in her old pasture.
Good point. Very good point. It could be because it didn't have a companion. So why do you want to create the same circumstance of fear and connection that it came from? If you get a new horse, you want to set it up for how it is. You want to make sure that's free access to food. You don't want to make it depend on you on food. You don't want to make it think this is my last meal. You don't want to think the food's going to go away tomorrow. You let the horse be a horse. The best thing you can do to a new abandoned horse at any sanctuary is put it with freaking horses and leave it alone. Let it get established in the herd. Let the horses talk to it. Let it learn the horse language with other horses. Let it break the bonds and create distance from whatever it came from, whether it was abuse, neglect, or whatever. Put it with horses for a week or two, a month. Let it get 100% comfortable to where it has nothing to worry about now, and then start your process. When you get a new horse and you're trying to do this when in a day or two, you're just creating more of a problem, more frustration. You're trying to create things that are going to make you fight against this draw when had you given it a couple of weeks and let them become friends and let them work as herd and work this horse around this horse. Let this horse see this horse do things that you want this horse to do. Let this horse follow this horse through mud, over tarps, over things. Use the drawn connection of this horse to teach this horse without having to do it. You can teach two horses at once. No, Rick, you have to break that damn bond. You got to show them who's boss. It's herd sour, buddy sour, herd locking on. That's bad. And everybody tells me it's bad. And I got to show this little young horse who came from a neglected place that I'm in charge and who's the boss. That's just the crappiest attitude in the world to deal with horses.
Makes sense.
And pressure, 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 pressure.
Immediate connection, and now she's dependent. So the only way to break that is gradually increasing the distance.
That is not the only way to break that. Okay, again, when you start saying there's only one way, and you start believing the bullshit minutia that people are giving out, that's when you start doing things that isn't tried, tested, and in the horse's best interest. It's in your best interest because you're right. It's in your best interest because that's the only thing you know. It's in your best interest because that's the only thing that you can get to work. It doesn't make it the best thing for the horse to grow into a good horse.
Between the horses, when you're working with
also, I'm wondering if we would have left Voodoo in the pasture, left him to graze, and just brought her out only, if that would have been...
You're creating the same thing. Why leave her in a pasture? If you want to work this horse, work her around this horse. If this is what the horse wants and it's easier, why not work the horse around the other horse? Why is that such a horrible thing? Well, Rick is not paying attention to me, and I have to show him his boss, and I have to make sure he respects me, and I'm not going to have a horse being disrespectful and not listen to me. You've had the horse for what? A day? A week? And you want the horse to be perfect? You want the horse to abandon the only thing it found comfort? It came from a neglected, abused place, and you're trying to change all that in one day to show Moose Boss because that's, according to her, the only way to break it is to work them more away. Now, working them at a little greater distance isn't the worst thing in the world, but it needs to be gradual. You need to at least establish a relationship. You shouldn't be on the damn horses already. That's their first problem. See, I always say horse people don't know what they don't know. So they know they have this frame of reference that here's what I know, here's what I've seen, here's watch a video, here's what somebody told me. And they know that. So they work from the reference that they know everything because they know that. And they have no idea what they don't know because there's just so much not to know. There's so much. I mean, lifelong horsemen have worked with hundreds of horses. Now, each time these people get a new horse to do something different, they'll learn a little bit more. But that's going to take years for them to learn a whole bunch of lessons. And if they learn the right way, it's going to make it a lot easier down the road. Every horse they get after this, if they learn to take their time, to slow down, to not get on them without a saddle, to make sure the horse can give the pressure and you can control it on the ground before you ever think about getting on it. That's going to make every horse they get after this much easier and better. I mean, it's just foundation, foundation, foundation. Groundwork is foundation for horses. If you can't do everything you want to do on the ground before you get on their back, you're setting the horse up to fail. And I hate setting horses up to fail because they will fail. They have no choice. Neither one of these horses have a choice on what halter to wear, on what human gets on their back when they're ready, on who pulls on them, on who separates them. They have no choices whatsoever. So when you, as a stupid human, make the decision to be the decision maker for a horse, anytime it goes wrong, it is your fault. It is never the horse's fault. You're the one with all the decision process. You're the one that gets to make all the choices. If it goes wrong, you went too fast. You did it wrong. You tried to rush it. You didn't know what you were doing. You made the mistake. You put too much pressure. You didn't know how to release. It's always, always, always the human's fault when it goes wrong. And conversely, if it goes right, you did it right. You set the horse up to succeed. Humans are great at tooting their horn when something goes right on how great they are. But for some reason, when it goes to shit, it's never their fault. It's always the stupid horse, the last trainer. The horse was abused. It was neglected. It was the other mean horse. It was this. They have 1,001 excuses when it goes wrong. But when it goes right, man, humans are always right up front, ready to take the credit. Look what I did. Look how good I am.
Smarter.
That would have been a hot mess.
That would have been worse.
Yeah, that would have been really bad.
Yeah. I would. So now we have multiple people dealing with horses. Again, never train a horse with multiple people. The horse gets confused. They don't know who to listen to. This horse is like, I got two people here. I got a person here. I got my horse here. I don't know where I'm at. This person is pulling. They're pulling on this horse. I don't know. This horse got his ears back. Is this horse talking to me? Is he talking to them? I don't know what to do. This is confusion. This is chaos in a horse's mind. But Rick, you should teach a horse so it learns how to work under different things and you don't want to make it easy. You do that later. You have to progress to that point. You don't do it on day one or week one or when you're jumping on a horse's back. All that is wrong. Is this horse around a horse in damn flip-flops? Are you kidding me? When this horse steps on her foot, it's going to be stupid horse. She's going to scream and the horse is going to panic and go, oh my God, last time I was around this woman, she screamed, scared the hell out of me. Next thing I know, last time I was around this woman, she jumped on the ground and grabbed her foot and tried to attack me. I don't know what happened, but she screamed, tried to attack me. No, you stepped on her foot and it hurt her. But the horse doesn't know that. When you set horses up for chaos, and when chaos happens, you think you know what happened. And you will tell me later, the horse just stepped on me for no reason. And when I fell, because it hurt to get her leg off, she wouldn't get her leg off because she was mean and she wanted to stand on me. She didn't know she was hurting you. She's standing on the ground. You're screaming, acting like a maniac. She doesn't know you were out there barefooted and now she's standing on your foot. I mean, it's just so crazy the way horses get blamed for shit.
Well, Ellie, I want to show you something.
Yeah.
What you did in the old days. Keep doing this.
Okay.
A lot of folks don't know what a foot is. When someone says, give me a foot, watch what I'm going to do.
All right,
here we go.
Here we
go,
Lee. Yeah, we did that before.
You done it before?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, this guy's trying to teach and he's trying to pass on something he did a long time ago. Foot up. I got no problem with that. That's great. What I have a problem is, shouldn't be giving somebody a foot up on a horse that's not ready to ride. You shouldn't be getting on a horse that's not ready to ride. Shouldn't be riding a horse without a pad and a saddle. I mean, there's 1,000 things that did wrong on this, but the foot up was actually pretty good. He did a good job. I'm also going to say when she got on a horse,
there we go. Look, Ellie.
She sat down. Watch her weight shift on the horse's back. She doesn't slam and buckle the horse. She actually sits down pretty softly.
Yeah, we did that before.
You done it before?
Even though she went high, even though I think her boot hit her back, which I tell people all the time, women do that all the time. Did it hit it? Let me see if I got to eat my words. Ooh, I don't know if it hit it or not. Okay, so not too bad. A lot of women are lazy when they get on a horse and they rub it across the horse's back and they cause a horse to buck. If you get on a new horse, the last thing you want to do is make your butt hit their, your shoe hit their butt, because it'll cause a buck and a fleer, and they usually flight because they've been used, somebody's hit them on the back, somebody's hit them on the back with a rope, so they've learned that anytime I get hit on the back area, I'm supposed to go forward and get away from it. It's in their blind area, they can't see, so when they get touched or bumped where they can't see, a lot of times they'll react. But I don't know if she made contact or not, so anyway.
That before.
You done it before?
Yeah,
that's called a foot.
We did it.
For folks who don't know, that's called a foot.
And he's taking off. I don't want him to, so I'm going to emergency. I'm going to disengage.
He's taking off, and I don't want him to. How does he know that? How does he know you don't want to get off? How do you know that every time someone else got on this horse, they let him walk off in a horse-learned behavior? How do you know? How's the horse supposed to know what you want? See, she says he's taking off and I don't want him to. How does he know that?
And he's taking off. I don't want him to, so I'm going to disengage.
So she's using the cool terminology. I'm disengaging his hips. Why do you disengage the hips? What's the reason for disengaging him? Can you disengage the hips without the reins? Can you disengage the hip without his head? Did you make him flex, or did you just use brute force and pull his head around? Does a horse know he's disengaging because of a cue? Or is he disengaging because you yanked on his head and pulled it around? See, when you can ask all these questions, that tells me the horse is guessing. The horse isn't learning, he's guessing. It tells me you're not teaching, you're just bullying. You're doing things. You may see it, oh, see, look, he disengaged, I did it right. No. Did the horse learn that through cues? Does he understand it? Can you replicate that? If the horse knew that, he wouldn't have done it. Why didn't you teach him what disengaging was on the ground so he knows how to give his head? See, you got on the horse too soon, and anything that happens after that is just frustration, confusion, guessing, maybe if and buts and coconuts, and maybe you get the right answer. Maybe you don't get thrown off. Maybe the horse doesn't buck and flip over. Maybe the horse doesn't run off out of fear. Maybe, maybe, maybe. You don't want a bunch of maybes when you're on a horse's back. You can deal with some maybes when you're on the ground because you're in a better position. You don't want a bunch of maybes when you're on her back.
Go. Until he stops, go. Good boy. Good ho.
Okay, so she pets him like a dog. Good boy. She gives pressure. People don't understand when you rub or pet a horse, that's pressure. She is giving pressure. Does the horse know that that's release? Does the horse know that he's a good boy because she said good boy? I mean, there's that one damn trainer that says good girl every time the horse breathes. Does the horse know what that means? No. This horse doesn't know good boy. He doesn't know that. She gave him a little bit of release on the pressure. She's not pulling. The horse understands that.
Where are we going?
We'll pull back the way we did.
Notice how she kind of yanks there. She didn't give a cue. She's good about bending her leg and trying to really over-exaggerate. And when you're teaching a horse, I get you can over-exaggerate. But this horse is so confused, he doesn't know what this means. He's not learning what that means. Over time, if she does this the same way, the same wrong way every time, he will learn every time she yanks on my head and every time she picks her foot up and puts more weight on me and leans on my spine and causes pain, I have to go this way. So maybe I will learn over time that when she lifts a head, I'll just turn to the left. Is that really a good way to teach a horse? No, it's not.
Oh my gosh.
There you go.
Separate ways to see what happens.
Come on, Voodoo. Good boy.
Good boy. What did he do that was good boy? Did he look the other way? Is that the good boy? Did he not run off? Is that the good boy? Did he not buck? Is that why he got the good boy? Did he not get pulled on the reins? Is that why he got the good boy? Did she kick him to go forward? Is that why he got the good boy? Who knows why he got the good boy?
Good boy.
Words mean nothing. Actions mean everything. Horses don't care what you say. They care what you do.
Chill, Ivy, chill. Chill, Ivy.
He's trying to get under this hay. He's eyeing it. So I'm using my right foot on his shoulder. On his right shoulder.
I hit her right beside the hay.
Okay. He's trying to get along with the hay.
Ellie, really can make fun of this? Can you just like follow me?
All right. We would have given you a foot.
Oh, who's going to give me a foot?
Me? I don't know.
Good boy. Good boy. So when horses...
Okay. So there'll be a lot of people that'll say, never let go of the reins when you're on a new horse. If he runs off, you're screwed back. Look, this girl's... Maybe she's got more confidence than brains. I'm not saying she's stupid. Letting go of the reins on a horse to me isn't that big of a deal. But I usually get on horses that I know are safe. I'm not sure I would let go of a horse that I haven't ridden much. And again, I'm a little confused on whether this horse has been here longer than the other one. So I may be saying some statements. But when you get on a new horse, letting go of the reins, if you don't understand a horse, probably ain't a good thing. I'll let go of the reins on my horses anytime, all the time, no big deal. Because I know if they bolt or whatever, I can pick up the reins and it ain't going to be that big of a deal. I don't need the reins for balance, so I let go of my reins. There's a lot of people out there in that structured horse world that, oh my God, that's a cardinal sin. You never let go of the reins. It's dangerous, and she doesn't have a helmet on, and she doesn't have a saddle. And look, a saddle hurts the horse. She doesn't have good balance. If she's trying to teach the horse to use her legs, she needs to get her feet in stirrups on a saddle, get rid of the pain, the spine, and get the horse to where he can concentrate on one thing. When you have a horse concentrating on multiple things, pressure on the back, pulling on the reins, arms up, herd sour, hay, you've got all these distractions and you're trying to teach a horse, that would be like trying to teach a kid math while he's playing a video game. How much math you think a kid's going to learn while he's playing a video game? Not freaking much, because he's worried about other things and winning and playing a video game. This horse is worried about safety and the baby horse and do I want food and the pain on my back and the reins, and he's got 1,000 things going on. Is that the best learning environment to really teach a horse? See, I don't think these guys are teaching anything but bad lessons, but they're having fun. They're not hurting the horse. These horses are both have good attitudes. There's not really anything critical going on. That doesn't mean it couldn't be critical, but so far it's not the end of the world.
Lick their lips. If you're playing a game with them, trying to teach them something, and after it's done, they lick their lips.
Yeah. Okay. Sorry, Faith. I
can't watch. Okay, so we didn't see him jump on a horse's back from on top of here. Bad. Small horse. He's too heavy. No saddle. And now we've got his weight coming from a high position straight down. Another reason why you don't ride a horse without a saddle. Notice the horse's butt comes all the way up past his hip line. That is because the horse's body is sagging because of his weight. When you curve a spine like that, that's painful. It's not good. It's not good for young horses. It can hurt. A horse's bones do not fuse until they're 5 years old, which is why in the old days you never rode or start a horse at five. You can do groundwork. You can get them used to saddle. You can do a lot of things. You might be able to put kids on them. But you don't ride or get on a horse until they're 4 or 5, because that's when their bones finally fuse. That's when they're really considered a horse. Until they're 5, they're still considered a colt or filly, which is not a full-grown horse. So bad, bad lesson here. Bad experience, bad problems, creating a bad situation.
Oh, no.
Rope hanging, good thing, bad thing. It's okay. Horse may get rope burn. If the horse panic rears and flips over, he's going to have a broken back. The horse is going to be learned that I can get people off by rearing. Again, when you start off bad by getting on a horse you shouldn't, all kind of bad lessons can be learned later that you can't prevent. Horses get hurt. People get hurt because of his decision, not the horse's decision, because of his decision to do something that he shouldn't be doing, that he doesn't know what he doesn't know, that he doesn't realize the dangers and the bad things by getting on a horse that's not ready, that you haven't prepared, that you don't know, that you haven't sacked out on the ground.
Oh no. Oh no.
All right, so in case you're wondering, we're trying to go without a bit. Obviously,
well, we're going to justify that the horse needs a bit. Look, you don't try, there's that word again, we're trying to go without a bit. You don't try, you don't need a bit. The reason why you're having problems is because you're doing it wrong. And if you put a bit in the mouth, you're still going to be doing it wrong. The only difference is the horse will feel pain. You will have more control because you can hurt the horse's mouth with a metal pain bit. And you will interpret that as, oh, I must be doing better. Oh, see, the horse works better with a bit. This horse needs a bit. No, the horse doesn't need a bit. You need to know what you're doing, and you don't need to use pain as a cheat because you don't know what you're doing. Educate yourself. Learn how to work the horse on the ground. Teach what the right answer is, and then you won't need a damn bit. Ugh, the fact that they're talking about a bit just pisses me off.
Gosh. She's not real sure what's going on around her face right now. Are you? What's wrong?
I'm just scared. Yeah, I am. I am for you.
So she's tried to bite me a couple of times.
Maybe because your heavy weight is hurting her and her back is buckled and she's in pain and her tail is active. And because you're ignoring all that, maybe that's why she's trying to bite you. Maybe your head being thrown is because you're pulling on the reins and you won't give a release because she's trying to tell you you're too heavy and you're hurting her. Maybe that's why this is happening. No, no, Rick, this horse needs a bit. She can't work in a rope halter and she needs a bit. That's what the idiots in a horse world will tell you.
So, we're not doing that. Say again?
I hope you can get off quickly enough if she goes crazy enough.
What I want to do is just...
If she goes crazy. See, terminology is, if she goes crazy. My terminology is, she's in pain, she's looking for release, and she will keep trying things till she gets it. And if she goes crazy, as they say, that just means I've tried everything else, and now I'm going to try something else to get release because I'm not ready for all this pressure. I'm not ready for this pain.
Just let her get used to me sitting here for a moment.
You don't get a horse used to sitting you when the horse is in pain, when the tail is so active and is telling you in pain. That's not getting a horse used to you. That's just creating pain. It's kind of like if I pull my car over your foot and I park the tire on your foot, and I go, I'm just going to leave the car sit here so you get used to the car being on your foot. Yeah, that's a great idea. I think that'll be my training method. I'll just run stupid humans over with my car, park my car, and I'm going to go, you know what? I'm going to use the same philosophy on you use on a horse. I'm just going to get you used to it. I'm going to, here, put your hand in the door well. I'm going to slam the door on your hand, and I'm not going to open the door because I'm going to get you used to your hand being in the door well. Nobody's got the foresight to say this horse is too small and I'm too big and I'm creating pain on this horse's back and I shouldn't be on it bareback, much less with a saddle because I'm too big. And Rick, so they didn't know. Why are you being mean to him? He asks for help. I'm telling him what he's doing wrong. He can listen. He can not watch the video. He can tell me I'm full of shit. He can do what he wants. He asks for help and I'm telling him what I think will help him.
Trying to see if we can just go with these halter reins that we have right now and seeing what she does. Now, Willie, she's turned around twice and bit me in the leg. This side, there's a three.
Oh, my God.
Three times. I've been bit three times.
Okay. Now, look, I don't think this guy has malicious bone in his body. He's not trying to be mean to this horse. He's not hurting it intentionally. But a horse doesn't care. It doesn't matter. If I run you over with a car and I say, dude, man, I'm sorry, it was an accident, I didn't mean to. Do you hurt any less? Of course not. Intent doesn't matter to a horse. A horse doesn't care what you say, doesn't care what you meant to do, doesn't care that you love it, doesn't care what you feel about it, doesn't care that you feel bad or good. He doesn't care. They only care what you do, and they react to what you do. This horse is reacting to what you're doing. Not what you're saying, not that you're laughing, not that you're filming. He's reacting to the pain of you on his back. That's it. And you ought to be able to figure that out and catch a clue that if a horse is trying to bite you, there is a reason. And instead of immediately jumping to the conclusion, the horse is stupid, the horse is mean, the horse is trying to show me who's boss, I can't get off because the girl in pink in the comments told me never get off. If you keep thinking in that stupid mindset, you will never learn how to read a horse. This horse is telling you with his tail, ears, head, and biting that it's in pain and you're hurting it. And you never see it. That's the problem. People don't listen to horses. They think they're too smart and they need to show the horse what's really happening.
I'm still on. I've been bit 3 times and I'm still on. Okay, no, no, no. So, please. Back four.
Oh, okay. Oh, no. Oh, God.
Okay, so I've swished my tail. I've tossed my head. I've tried to bite you. This is the horse asking 7 different ways, dude, I need you to get off my back. You're hurting me. I don't know what else to do. Maybe I'll jump up. Maybe I'll rear. The next step is either bucking or flipping over backwards to get you off me. And then when a horse flips over, you'll have some stupid human telling you the story. Man, I don't know what happened to a horse. For no reason, it just flipped off. It's dangerous. It's crazy. It's got bad breeding, man. It needs to be put down because it's trying to kill people. And let's just kill the horse. And that's, I see horses die all the time because of stupid shit like this. And it irritates me because I am the voice for the horse. I'm not here for your feelings or her feelings. You ask for my opinion, and I'm telling you, you're setting this horse up to fail. You're setting this horse up and any other horse that you do this to fail because you don't listen to the horse.
Oh, all right. All right. All right.
If you keep...
Oh, gosh. All right.
I'm out. Lester's out.
Best move he did. He should have done it a lot earlier. When a horse first bit him, he should have went, wonder why this horse is biting me. The second time it tried to bite him, he should have went, it's tried to bite me twice. I wonder why it's trying to bite me. The third time it bit him, it should have been, dude, he's bit me twice and 3 times. Something's going on. Let me get off and figure out what's going on. But he never had that thought process. Because he's in the mindset of the other idiots that are giving advice. Never get off a horse. Never let the horse make you get off. Always show the horse who's boss. You should have never got on the horse. Reins pulling. Look, this guy, again, I'm going to say it again. This guy isn't a bad dude. I kind of like the dude. I mean, I wish he had somebody experienced out there giving him some good advice. He can turn in and be a good horseman if he listens to the horse. Go to my website, dude. I'm telling you, thinklikeahorse.org, not .com, .org, thinklikeahorse.org. Go there. Read it. Understand a horse. I've got a horsemanship page about horsemanship tips. I've got a medical page about horse medical issue. I got feeding. I got a hoof page. I've got years of experience that I'm trying to share for free for anybody that wants to read it. The only problem is, it takes time. You have to invest in order to get the knowledge. You don't have to do videos and ask for advice on the internet and have a bunch of idiots tell you something. You can accept responsibility, read for yourself, test it, and see if it works, and understand a horse. You don't understand a horse, and you don't understand pressure and release. And those are your two biggest downfalls. Once you understand those two things, a lot of things will get better. I don't know what this thing is.
Okay. Ellie, your turn.
Oh, really?
Jamie, you're up.
Again, anytime I see somebody holding a horse right here, trapping, pressure, pulling, insecure, doesn't understand a horse, makes the horse insecure, makes the horse nervous, makes the horse feel trapped. See, people think this is control when in fact it just traps a horse and it's less control. Good horseman always leads with a long, loose rope. Doesn't have to get next to the horse to have control. Understands how to take the horse's head away. Understands how to lead a horse, how to read a horse, how to know when a horse is going to react. He doesn't understand all that. So because he doesn't know what he doesn't know, he does what makes him feel in control. actually gives him less control and makes the horse more uncontrollable.
Y'all get me? Let's just out and deuces. That was a good first ride.
That's enough. Come on, let's go feed her.
Yeah, we're going to figure out what's up. Listen, there's 1,000 things we're doing wrong, folks.
Man, he got that shit right. High five, brother. That's one thing we agree on. So people come in here saying, Rick, you gave him a hard time. You didn't agree. I agree exactly with that comment. I want to hear it again.
Listen, there's 1,000 things we're doing wrong, folks.
Okay. The difference is, don't do them wrong. If you know you're doing it wrong, stop. Take time. Take the time it takes. Don't set the horse up. When you do things wrong, you set the horse up to fail. And you lead the horse down a path to learn bad lessons and to get hurt or to hurt you. Don't do the 1,000 things wrong. If you don't know if it's right or wrong, don't do it. Only do things you know that are right. Help the horse understand. Talk to the horse in horse language. If you can't speak pressure and release in horse language, the horse will never have a conversation and understand you. It will only understand bits, pains, pressure, manhandling, abusive shit that a lot of people tell you is how you train a horse. It's not true. It's all bullshit.
I get that. What I'd rather have is constructive criticism.
Tell us how to do it. Tell us how to, like, telling us how to do it right.
I would really admire folks who take the time to start and just
hands in the halter, grabbing. Look at the horse. He is so busy talking to the camera, he doesn't realize the horse is saying, dude, I feel trapped. Why are you pulling on me? Why are you getting... He doesn't know that he's got constant 100% pressure on his horse. He is making this horse hate being around him. He is making this horse think, man, if I could just get away from this guy. Every time I'm around this guy, he puts pressure on me. He pulls on the rein. He grabs my rein. I never get to relax. I never get to stand without him pulling pressure and harassing me. He doesn't see it that way because he doesn't know what he doesn't know.
Meyer, folks who take the time to start and just, I'll read it. If you'll just tell me what I'm doing wrong. Like I said, Dixie comes with a harness and a wagon. She's been used to pulling a wagon, and that's not what we're going to do with her.
The worst thing you could do is put this horse thinking because it came with a wagon that it knows how to pull it. This horse will kill itself, etc. if you tie something to it and drag it. Don't put a harness and have this thing pull a wagon. First of all, it's too damn young to be riding. It's probably too young to be pulling. Neither of these horses are wild or dangerous. The only dangerous things around them is the humans. And they can make them dangerous or they can make them safe. These horses will be a reflection of you. If the horse does good, then you did good.
She's doing the mouth thing. Remember when Voodoo did that at first?
Well, so she's doing the little mouth thing, but it's not because she has a bit in her mouth.
No, I think she's looking for it.
Oh, so...
Then he's hauling.
So that...
No horse looks for their bit. That's ignorant.
Might be a situation. Maybe she's... You can video that. She might be looking for a bit.
That's what I mean. Like, she's looking for, like, where's that piece of it?
That is absolutely the most craziest thing in the world. Yeah. You know what? Why don't I put a tight collar around your neck that I can shock you? And then when it's not on you, whatever you do, I'll say, oh, you must be looking for the shock collar I have around your neck. Let me put that on you. A bit is pain and a torture device. It's archaic. If you have to use a bit, you're doing it wrong.
All right, well, I will ask Joanne, and we'll find out more about her. But that was a pretty good first ride.
It was a horrible first ride. But anyway, he doesn't know that. So he can watch a video. I'm at 34 minutes. I gave a 3-part. That's an hour and a half lecture on things that he did wrong. And I didn't cover probably everything, but look, there's just so much to learn. And I use the old adage that if you call somebody and go, hey man, you've been building houses for 30 years. Can you tell me how to build a house, in the comment section? Cause I don't want to do it wrong. I mean, there's just no way in hell anybody can do that. Well, asking somebody how to be a good horseman in the comments section just ain't going to cut it, dude. Don't get advice on the internet. Find somebody who gets good success and who does things the right way, and they don't have to use pains, spurs, bits, and torture devices, and they're not running around fighting with the horse all the time, telling you how to show it to the boss. Find somebody who's got a decent relationship with a horse and emulate them and find out what they do. All right, my website, thinklikeahorse.org. Go there. You'll find a wealth of information. You'll probably find stuff that pisses you off. You'll probably find stuff that you don't agree with. That's okay. Don't get on new freaking horses. Okay? And we'll end that there. Hope that helps. And again, I don't think either of these people are bad. I don't think they're mean and evil. Don't be going there hating on them. If they're rescuing horses, they're trying to help horses, and they're asking for help, I'm trying to give them help. All right? Buddy, Mr. T, you're good boys. For you guys don't know, in case y'all never watch me, that's my horses.